I know I need to lose weight. I know I should eat better. I really should exercise. But once again this year, I resolved to make no New Year's resolutions because I know I'm going to break them. Now, that doesn't mean I won't try to improve myself in these areas, but, you know, knowing myself, I know that I'm going to drive by Casey's and stop and get a piece of pizza. And I know that I'm going to hate every second of exercise that I do. And I know that in my cooking, I'm going to add way more cheese and butter than the things call for. That's the way Mom does it. So, how about you? What did you resolve? And how do you think you're going to stick to it? Well, our Old Testament reading for today is perfect for New Year's Day because it starts with a resolution by God's people. This is what they resolve. I will recount the steadfast love of the Lord, the praises of the Lord, according to all that the Lord has granted me. Granted us, and the great goodness in the house of Israel that he has granted them according to his compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. That's a great resolution for us to make as well. Let us recount every day of the year 2023, let us recount the love of the Lord. And we do a great job of this every Sunday as we come into God's house to receive what he has to give us, both in the forgiveness of our sins at the Lord's Supper with the body and blood of Jesus, and with his very own words spoken from his mouth entering into our ears. But is there more than just that? So the prophet Isaiah goes on in the reading to quote the Lord as a reason why we should recount his steadfast love. For he says, this is verse 8, surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And then the prophet continues the reasoning behind recounting the Lord's steadfast love as he continues. He has become our Savior. In all our affliction, he was afflicted, and the angel of his presence saved us. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed us. He lifted us up and carried us all of the days of old. That sounds pretty compelling to me for wanting to recount the steadfast love of the Lord. Why wouldn't we respond to these things by recounting the steadfast love of the Lord since he has done all of that stuff? But here's the thing. It's easy to say these things. It is much harder to live them out. You see, just like we are terrible at keeping our New Year's resolutions, we too are terrible at living the way that God would have us live. See, the prophet Isaiah describes living the Christian life. He first reminds us what we should do as God's people. Recount the steadfast love of the Lord. He tells us why we should do that. Because he has become our Savior and redeemed us. But it isn't always easy to keep this in mind as we live out our daily lives. Now, you all know the definition of sin is this. It's knowing what God wants us to do and then doing anything but that. And again, I don't need to grill your conscience. You already know. But whenever we sin, inadvertently or not, we fail in recounting the steadfast love of the Lord. And it often happens in our actions toward other people. How would our treatment of others around us change if we look at them and think, you person in front of you, God has become the Savior for this person. In this person's affliction, God has been afflicted. God lifts up this person and carries them. Jesus died to forgive this person of all of their sins. The prophet Isaiah knows God's people all too well. God knows his people all too well. So look at what comes next in our Old Testament lesson. This is verse 10. But they rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit. Therefore God turned to be their enemy, and he himself fought against them. This is sin. And as I mentioned before, I don't mean to rake it into you over the coals. This is us failing at our New Year's resolutions. And we all knew that we would. This is us knowing what God has commanded and then often doing anything but that. Notice though that God doesn't want to be our enemy, but because of our own actions, we have made him our enemy. Paul often talks about being enemies of God throughout his letters in the New Testament. And we, in fact, grieve the Holy Spirit with our sin. Remember, the Holy Spirit, whose job it is to call us by the gospel, enlighten us with his gifts, and sanctify us and keep us in the true faith, he has to do that because we cannot, by our own reason or strength, believe in Jesus our Lord or come to him. That's straight out of the Catechism, as Luther explains the third article of the Creed. But thanks be to God that we are not kept there. Neither is Isaiah's people kept as enemies of God, grieving the Holy Spirit. Notice then what comes next, beginning at verse 11. Then God remembered the days of old, of Moses and his people. Where is he who brought them up out of the sea with the shepherd of his flock? Where is he who put in the midst of them his Holy Spirit, who caused his glorious arm to go at the right hand of Moses, who divided the waters before them to make for himself an everlasting name, who led them through the depths? So God, you led your people to make for yourself a glorious name. Now, as I read and studied this scripture passage in preparation for today, the old saying popped into my head that my mom used to say whenever she had to deal with us knot-headed kids. She said, I brought you into this world and I can take you out. See, as parents of children, sometimes when they are being especially bad and terrible, you know what we have to do? We have to go and give same thing. He calms down his anger over our sin. Again, sin is knowing what God clearly says and then doing anything but that. Often do our kids do that. God calms down and he remembers what he has done for us. What he's done for the people of the Old Testament through Moses. For us, God sent his only begotten Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to save us from sin. Christ Jesus had no sins of his own to die for, so he died for us. Jesus rose from the dead, breaking the power of death, so that we will live forever in paradise. In holy baptism, God washed away all of your sins. He marked you as ones redeemed by Christ the crucified and covered all of your sins with the robe of Christ's righteousness. At the Lord's Supper, Jesus gives you his very own body and blood to eat and drink for the forgiveness of your sins and the strengthening of your faith. God created you. God redeemed you. God has promised you eternal life. And whenever we rebel, whenever we don't hold up our end of the bargain, like failing our New Year's resolutions, the Lord God does not dwell on them. The Lord God looks at all that he has already done for us. Just like I pull out the baby picture and look at those cute, cuddly babies who are now screaming and yelling back at me. And God has mercy upon us and leads us in the way that we should go. All to make, as the prophet Isaiah says, his name glorious. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guide our hearts and minds in the one true faith, even into life everlasting. Amen. Now take a moment to worship our God with our tithes and offerings. being the first Sunday of the new year, we'll install our congregational officers for the coming year. So if you have been elected to an office, I invite you forward now for installation. Beloved in the Lord, the Holy Scriptures admonishes us that all things should be done decently and in order. To that end, the Constitution and bylaws of this congregation establish various offices to which men and women are elected and appointed to serve. In so doing, the Church follows the example of the early Christian Church as described in Acts chapter 6. It says this: the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, who we will appoint to this duty. For we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And the Apostle Peter writes in his first letter, "As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's very grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever." So you all have been elected for varying positions to serve of this congregation. You've been chosen to fulfill responsibilities. You are to work with the pastor that our life together in Christ may be orderly and pleasing in his sight. You are to see that the services of God's house are held after the proper times, that the word of God is purely preached and taught according to the Lutheran confessions, the sacraments of Christ are administered according to his institution, that provision is made for the Christian instruction of young and old, that the erring are admonished, and that the discipline is maintained. You are to see that the temporal affairs of the congregation are properly administered, and that proper support is provided for the workers of this congregation. You are to assist in caring for the poor and sick, in cultivating harmony among the members, in promoting the general welfare of this congregation, and in furthering the kingdom of Christ here and throughout the world. So in the presence of God and of this congregation, I therefore ask you, do you accept the offices entrusted to you? And do you promise faithfully to carry out your duties, trusting in the Lord and conforming yourself to his word in accordance with the faith of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? So, then answer, I do. So to you, congregation, beloved in the Lord, you have heard the promises of faithfulness spoken by these men and women, whom you have selected to serve as officers. Do you promise to support them in their work, to remember them in your prayers, and to work with them to the best of the abilities that God has given you, so that he may be glorified and his work be done in our midst? If so, then answer, we do.
We do.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I therefore install you as officers of Holy Cross Lutheran Church in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Almighty and merciful God enlighten and strengthen you in your offices, that you may be good and faithful stewards to the glory of his name and the good of his people. Go now in peace. Amen. Our service continues with our prayers. In addition to our prayers, we will pray for Harold Harms. Harold was hospitalized. Briefly, he is now recovering at home. So pray for Harold. Also, our third and fourth grade teacher, Mr. Drake, his father, was put on hospice care and is nearing the end of his life. So we pray for Armin Drake and Joseph as well. So please stand as we pray. Majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens are the work of your fingers. Yet you willed to save us in the most humble and sacrificial of ways. Already 8 days after being born of the Virgin Mary, your Son was at work for our salvation by fulfilling your law and shedding his blood. Receive our heartfelt thanks for the righteousness and forgiveness of sins we have obtained through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, Father in heaven, bless and keep us by your grace. Remember those in need who cry out to you. We pray especially for healing and comfort for Harold, Peter, Dixie, Tom, Arthur, Jesse, Marilyn, Ethelene, Marvin, Pat, Gabe, Jill, Russell, Bill, Rebecca, Tony, Delaney, and Armin Grafe and our teacher, Joseph. According to your will and wisdom, lift up your countenance upon them and give them peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Holy God, you invite your children to the table of your Son. Give us your Holy Spirit that we would discern Christ's body and blood in the sacrament and come with joyful and repentant hearts to receive the foretaste of the eternal feast. Strengthen us by this blessed communion, that we would love you above all and love one another in your name. Lord, in your mercy, gracious Father, in your steadfast love, you have put off the days of Jesus' return until the perfect time, when the number of your elect is complete. Keep your people watchful, vigilant, and awake with your gift of faith until that day. The same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The service continues on page 194. Page 194. We continue with the service of the sacrament. Well, that's not right. Page 208. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have given us a new revelation of your glory, that seeing you in the person of your Son, we may know and love those things which are not seen. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
right.
Christ on the same night when he was betrayed took bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, he also took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Soul in the one true faith, even into life everlasting. Depart in his peace, your sins are forgiven. Amen. Welcome to the Lord's table. Take heed to the true body of the Lord Jesus. The grace poured out of you at your baptism and strengthened. Body of the Lord Jesus. Grace poured out in the river of baptism, strength and preserving the truth. part of his feast, your sins are forgiven. Everything going on in our bulletin. highlight a few things here. This Friday, that's January the 6th, that's the day of Epiphany, we will have a regional ministry Epiphany service. That's all four of our congregations. We'll be hosting it here at Holy Cross. That's Friday at 7 p.m. There's, I think, three announcements. Okay. Council meeting next Sunday after church. Two Sundays from today, voters meeting also after church. Okay. So there's our warning. Regular quarterly voters meeting after church 2 weeks from today. Christmas decorations go down Saturday. What time? 10 o'clock? 10 o'clock Saturday. We need all the help we can get to take Christmas decorations down. Couples Club, we'll have a quick meeting, find Marvin after church. One thing, just to get ready, this time of year, the Colcamp Church Alliance, that's all of the Christian churches in town, we're starting our Super Bowl. Remember, that's where we collect canned goods in competition with the other churches. This year we are collecting soup. We haven't done soup in a few years. Again, the goal, we almost beat St. Paul's last year. We were like 50 cans short. Okay? Ionia Methodist wins every year if they cheat because they start collecting the soap. But we're going to start collecting canned soup. So go and buy a case or two of soup. And we'll start collecting that for the Super Bowl for our food pantry. So take note of that. I think that's all I have. Any other announcements? Seeing none, close the last hymn, 386.